His new book is called A Wild Swan and Other Tales, which is beautifully illustrated by Yuko Shimizu. And in it, Cunningham reimagines classic fairy tales, keeping the original darkness while simultaneously bringing the tales into the here and now. Please welcome Michael Cunningham. So before we begin, I know that a lot of us, our hearts are heavy with what's happened in Paris in the last day. So I think we'd be remiss if we didn't talk about that a little bit, about why do we do what we do?
Oh, God.
Sorry to lay that burden on you, but you know it just gives you pause.
No, we Rob and I agreed before we came out that it would be grotesque to just start talking about a book without spending at least a little bit of time on what's just happened. All I can say, really, is that I think back to 9/11, in the immediate aftermath of which many of us who write books or paint or create anything felt like, yeah, right. You know, we need more books. Yeah. Please don't destroy the world. I have a novel here. It was, and then after some time had passed, we realized that's exactly why we need books and art in all forms, to witness, to commemorate, that art is part of what survives the worst that can happen.
Mm-hmm. I think that's doubly so here, sitting in this, you know, we are in a library, which kind of stands for everything we value and cherish. You
know, absolutely.
And which is often the target, the first target of fascists and fundamentalists. Our ability to freely choose what we read, and
it's kind of a perfect place to be today. Yeah. Maybe just a moment of silence.
Okay.
Everybody.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Could you read us a few pages to
sure.
get a flavor of,
sure.
of the book?
Anything in particular, or just should I just pick something?
Just pick something.
All right. Just a second. You know, this is a shortened version of the introduction. It's called Disenchant. This piece of paper is entirely extraneous. Most of us are safe. If you're not a delirious dream the gods are having, if your beauty doesn't trouble the constellations, nobody's going to cast a spell on you. No one wants to transform you into a beast or put you to sleep for 100 years. The middling maidens, the ones best seen by candlelight, corseted and rouged, have nothing to worry about. The pudgy, pockmarked heirs apparent are immune to curse and hex. Most of us can be counted on to manage our own undoings. Vengeful deities seek only to devastate the rarest, the ones who have somehow been granted not only bower and trumpet, but comeliness that startles the birds in the trees, coupled with grace, generosity, and charm so effortless as to seem like ordinary human qualities. Who wouldn't want to fuck these people up? Which of us does not understand the demons and wizards compelled to persecute human mutations clearly meant by deities thinking only of their own entertainment to make almost everyone feel even lonelier and homelier, more doubtful and blamed than we actually are? Please ask yourself, if you could cast a spell on the ludicrously handsome athlete and the lingerie model he loves, or on the wedded movie stars whose combined DNA is likely to produce children of another species entirely, would you? Does their aura of happiness and prosperity, their infinite promise, irritate you even a little? Does it occasionally make you angry? If not, blessings on you. If so, however, there are incantations and ancient songs. There are words to be spoken at midnight beside bottomless lakes hidden deep in the woods, or at any point where three roads meet. These curses are surprisingly easy to learn.
I think that intro perfectly captures the wicked joy of this book. You seem to, did you have fun writing this? Because, I mean, it sure comes across.
You know, I actually did. And I suspect you have talked to enough writers to know to be very thrifty with that particular question. Because
yes.
People tend to come up to you
yeah.
after you've cranked out some 400-page tome and said, you must have had a lot of fun writing this.
Yeah, oh, crawling through mud and barbed wire is great.
Idea. Really, 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 you read that big monster mess of a book and you thought I was having fun? That's what you have to offer me? In this case, however, the answer is yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, you know, anything, writing always fucks you up. It's always not what you quite wanted it to be. You always feel like you're trying to work with your elbows rather than your fingers, that you are a kind of human blunt instrument, and that there's a better phrase just beyond the range of your brain's capacity.
Right.
But yeah.
I mean, you're failing better. I mean,
thank you, Sam Beckett. But this was this and the little book about Provincetown are the only two I've written that I actually. Hey, writers make too much of the torment of it all. If it was just pure torture, say, well, then darling, consider another occupation.
Right.
You know?
How did it fit in with the Snow Queen? The writing of that did it?
You know, the Snow Queen, my last novel. does borrow the name from the Hans Christian Andersen fairy tale and is very, very loosely a riff on that fairy tale, but is really not in any way a retelling of the Snow Queen.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, I've been doing these for years. These little fairy tales. I don't know what kind of relationship there is between you know two books, one with something.
But were you writing the fairy tales while you were also writing the Snow Queen?
I was writing the fairy tales while I was writing the last several novels.
Oh really?
You know what happens to most writers I know is suddenly you're driving along in the big Buick that is the novel, and you hit a tree. You stop. You just don't know how you got to where you got and where you need to go from there. And I've learned for my own purposes that the worst thing to do is force it. You just need to let it sit for a while. But I don't want to just not write while the novel sort of picks itself up and finds its way. So I would write these little fairy tales. And then I had 7 or 8 of them over the years, and I thought, well, a collection, really? Yeah.
Did you, I mean, they're wonderfully formally inventive, too. Some are in the second person. Did you, mm-hmm. With the second person ones, did you want to implicate us? Do you, way?
I find that the questions of the voice in terms of first person, second person, mm-hmm. third person seem to arrive for some of us on the level of pure intuition. It has to do with, in any particular story or novel, with how close or how far from the characters and the readers you want to stand. It's inexplicable. Everything I've ever written has just instantly been in the first, third, or more rarely the second person. When I'm in I teach writing a little bit, and when I hear somebody say, "I wonder if you should think of retelling this," but in the first person, I kind of gasp. You know? It's like saying, "I wonder if you should think of completely changing your identity and moving to another country and starting mm-hmm. over." I mean, I guess you could.
Right. So your it's voice first.
I don't know if it's voice first, but voice is not a decision.
Right.
It's not a conscious decision. I can answer a lot of questions. There are a few I can't, and this is one. Is just mm-hmm. some stories seem to want to be told in the first person, second person. You got me.
Right. So when you come to like Rumpelstiltskin, the little man, when you start reimagining that, it just this is the way in.
Yeah, that one's in the second person too, isn't it? Yeah. Well, you know, I guess if I were to sort of look at my own book as if I hadn't written it, it does seem that the two that are written in the second person both insist on a certain, shall we say, more empathetic view of, in one case, the witch in Hansel and Gretel, and mm-hmm. in the other case, Rumpelstiltskin. So there may be some relationship there that I was trying to sort of, if not exonerate, at least illuminate right. these two particular, very familiar figures who have been nothing but sort of forces of darkness in our imagination since those stories were first told. And I wanted a little more, what's going on with the witch? Mm-hmm. Why does Rumpelstiltskin want a child that badly?
Yeah.
Why is that?
The intro reminds me also of Umberto Eco has this wonderful riff saying, "It's very boring to talk about winners. The real literature is always about losers. Madame Bovary is a loser. Julian Sorrell is a loser. I'm only doing the same job. Losers are fascinating. Winners are stupid because they usually win by chance." It's a little harsh, but
well, it's a little harsh. I would, and you know, who am I to go up against Umberto Eco? But I would say winners are less dramatically interesting, and maybe even go so far as to say that I feel like one of the purposes of books of fiction is to accompany us in our lives. It's to entertain and to increase our powers of empathy with others. But it's also a mate. It's a way of reminding us, we know this already, but a good novel, I think, always reminds us that we're not alone. That we're not the only people who've ever felt this way, whatever that way may be. And I think we generally need that kind of companionship more urgently in the more difficult periods when we feel like losers than we do when we feel like winners.
Right. But I think also with the sort of Disneyfied version of fairy tales of happily ever after, that there's some kind of we all have this intuitive feeling that it's unsatisfying, that happily ever after is actually kind of boring.
Well, that, you know, that was one of the things that sort of, that was one of the notions behind these sort of retellings of the fairy tales. There were my parents read to me, bless them, every night when I was a kid. I was a story junkie. I was an addict. Another one. No, I'll do anything. do you want this toy? No, go to bed. But I always had questions, and one of the ones that I seem not to have tired of asking was, well, my mother or father would get to, and they lived happily ever after, and I would just sort of sit there like, go on. And no, honey, that's the end. No, that can't be the end. Yeah. Like, they're just going to the castle. Does she like it in the castle? are the king and queen glad to have her there? Where's happily ever after? Really?
Yeah.
And you know, my mother would like a Newport and say, "Well, it just is."
So it was left up to you. Well, particularly like Snow White. That to me was you know the. That got really interesting for me.
That's actually one of my personal favorites.
Yeah, because it gets, like, what happens after the rescue? And that's where the story starts. It's wonderful.
I hope this, it's a short story. I don't think this is too much of a spoiler. It basically imagines that after finding Snow White, supposedly dead, in a glass casket and kissing her awake and taking her to the castle, the prince develops this fetish. And he needs her to play dead so he can kiss her awake every night.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome. I was like, ooh. That's good. So in the Venn diagram of like, where do you fit in? Where do you... Not in that story. Sorry. But just... In the fairy tales in general, I mean, there are sort of modern elements. You bring this, you know, there's villages and thatched huts and things like that, but there's also a subway ride and, you know. When you're, you know, sort of imagining yourself in this world.
You know, these are riffs on my favorite fairy tales. I attempt to go sort of deeper into certain questions of character, like, why would you do that? Why would you marry the king who was going to have you executed if you couldn't spin straw into it, like that? Mm-hmm. But they're homages. I love these stories. These are not sort of, you know, wise ass, smart boy retellings of crude older works. I love and honor these stories, and so I didn't want to entirely remove them from their time, which is usually some vaguely medieval Europe. They're kings,
right?
And thatched huts we imagine about 14th century, but mm-hmm. they're never that specific. And I just thought if there were a combination of, you know, little medieval villages and laundromats, it would sort of pull it out of time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it definitely has that timeless feel, and I think the illustrations also add to that. Mm. They're amazing.
I bow down to Yuko Shimizu, the illustrator. You can't believe how beautiful these pictures are.
Did you seek her out, or how did this come about?
I found her on the internet.
Really?
Yeah. I had sort of imagined that my publisher would have this whole files of illustrators. They don't really. I mean, and a lot of illustrators are for do children's books, right, which is not right for this book. And we kind of looked around, and nobody I could find seemed exactly right for these stories. And I Googled illustrators.
Really?
And got a bunch of people come up on not really. And then there were these really dark, magical, strange illustrations by Yuko, and I thought, oh, please, Yuko, please. I bet you're out of my league. I bet you're out of my price range. But we sent her the book, and she said yes.
Because they're perfect. I mean, they just really evoke the sort of mysterious and darkness and... Yeah.
Part of the fun was when we met for the first time, she'd of course read the book, and she said, what were you thinking of in terms of the illustrations? And I said, I'm thinking of whatever you're thinking of. You have no instructions. I want you to just read the stories and pull the image that feels most right to you.
Because I remember for me, when I was reading fairy tales when I was young, I mean, part of it was like the Grimm's illustrations were just as terrifying as the tales often, you know.
They were the Arthur Rackham illustrations that we had. I was so freaked out by that book. I didn't even go near the bookshelf where it was. I went the long way around the room as if the book itself was gonna jump out and do something to me. Yeah.
Yeah, when I had kids of my own, I'd sort of blocked that out, and then I went to read them to my kids, and I was like, "Oh my God!"
I know. We have complicated feelings about the sanitized Disney versions, but you know, go back and read the originals, and imagine reading these to a 5 or 6 year old. You are going to screw that kid up. there's some really dark, scary, perverse, and horrible Christian morality, and nothing that's absent from the Disney pictures exactly. But I'm not quite the enemy of the Disney versions as some people are. Mm-hmm.
But did your parents read you the originals?
Yeah. And you know,
and you're fine.
No, you have no idea. You know, they read me the originals. They were good parents, and they sort of developed a feel for my tolerance level, like Little Match Girl.
Oh yeah.
They realized, okay, we're not doing any more dead orphan stories.
Yeah.
You know, they actually chose a little bit for me because I've gone back and read some of the ones they didn't read me and thought, thank you, Mom and Dad.
Yeah.
Thank you for skipping the girl who trod on a loaf, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah. What about Greek myths? Greek myths, did they read
Oh,
the
yeah,
myths?
I love Greek myths. Yeah. We had the Dolores book, yeah.
Yeah, because those are also, can be...
But for some reason, they didn't scare me the way the fairy tales did. Maybe because they seemed so much from another time. I don't know. And, you know, the gods, goddesses behave very badly, of course, but more out of hubris and meanness than they didn't feel evil to me. There's a strain of actual devilish darkness in the best fairy tales.
Yeah, and well, that comes through in yours, some of yours. I mean, in the title story, when the queen turns her 12 stepsons into swans, you have this wonderfully wicked line, do we blame her? Do we really?
Yeah.
I mean, you're a little sadistic in there, I think, to some extent.
Well, you know, I think part of what the writer's job is, certainly my sense of my job, is I think of myself as a state-appointed attorney. My characters are my clients, and I know some of them are guilty. But in this particular court, you don't get off by some bogus misrepresentation of the facts that makes it look like you didn't commit the crime you committed. You get off if you can convince the jury that the crime was inevitable given the person and the situation. Mm-hmm. So, yes, you marry a king, his wife has died, he has 12 sons. You suddenly are the mother of 12 boys, none of whom you raised from infancy. You turn them into swans. Do you blame her? Do you really?
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, I buy it. Mm. I don't know if I would do it, but since you were dealing with sort of confines of the, you know, the actual fairy tales, did you feel at all restricted, or did you just trust your intuition to run? I mean, did you give yourself permission to break out? You know,
and well, yeah, sometimes restrictions are great. Sometimes restrictions are exactly what you want. And, you know, there could be nothing worse than just thinking, well, okay, write a novel. What's it going to be? It was kind of great to have the source material, and I did try, as I said, to be relatively faithful to the stories. What I found over and over again was that when I looked at the characters and tried to sort of figure out things that had been mysterious in the fairy tales, mm-hmm. Jack and the Beanstalk. Jack climbs the beanstalk 3 times, robs the giant 3 times, and each time, the giant's wife lets him in. First time, sure, hot little dude, come on. You know, lonely up here. But then he comes back. Mm-hmm. She knows what he's going to do, and she lets him in a second time. What's going on in that marriage?
Yeah.
And I found that when I started looking at that, the endings tended to change. Yeah. So the story, most of the stories are faithful to their sources up to the 9/10 point, and then many of them turn out differently because I have just imagined motives for these people that change the ending.
Well, also, like, some of them just beg the question, like the monkey paw, you know, the people paralyzed by the third wish because the first two have been so devastating that they're just, it's just hovering there.
That one's sort of an anomaly. Do you know the story of the monkey's paw? Yeah, that's not really a fairy tale. I just figured, I just love it so much that I put it in there. And, well, again, I don't think this is too much of a spoiler. Famously, the mother and father used the third wish to prevent their son from coming back from the dead because they realized that he will come back as some dramatically altered creature. And in my version, they save that third wish and he comes back.
Yeah, it's just, it's utterly chilling. It's really, really terrifying. What surprised you when you were writing these? I mean, did you have surprise yourself?
It was sort of a constant series of little surprises. All of them really stemming from the notion that I needed to figure out for my own satisfaction why the miller's daughter would want to marry somebody who was going to cut off her head, what it would actually be like to be the 12th prince who was brought back to physical manhood except for one swan wing because his sister didn't have time to finish the 11th magic cloak. What would that be like? Okay. Yeah. And that was always surprising. And that's what kind of where the fun came in.
Yeah. What about Beauty and the Beast? That one really, I love that one.
Good. I mean,
that just seemed so, I love characters that you're just sort of like, no, don't. And, you know. They do.
Well, yeah, in Beauty and the Beast, I'm really not going to give that too much away about that one, but, you know, in pretty much every version of Beauty and the Beast, from the Cocteau film to the Disney film, we're kind of in love with the Beast. I mean, all the better when he turns into a prince because, you know, it's easier to buy shoes for him, and you know, and your parents are happier about it. Yeah. But we've always kind of romanticized the Beast, and when the old Cocteau movie, when he turns into this kind of awful, I feel that only a gay man can say this, faggot Prince,
right,
with long, you know, horrible long golden curls and this smarmy smile, yeah, and lace, yeah, cuffs, and Garbo sort of famously exited the theater when she saw it saying, "Bring me back my beast." So there's always been, in that story, there's always been a sort of romance of the beast. And I got to thinking, okay, have you dated a beast?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know, do you actually know what you're talking, you know, okay, I can introduce you to some people. Go ahead, romanticize them.
Yeah.
Let's talk about this kind of collective fascination some of us have with, you know, the rough, the untamable, the real man. Go ahead. Marry him. See what happens.
Yeah. It's just such a wonderfully wicked tale. Should we open it up for a few audience questions?
I'd love to try.
Anybody have any questions? We actually have a mic, if there are any.
Questions, comments, want to tell us a story?
Yeah.
Oh, in the back.
You don't need to use the mic. I'll repeat the question if you're all the way back there.
It's a long trip.
Okay, I was just wondering, thank you for the presentation.
Thank you.
Question is whether Anne Sexton's transformations have any effect, or any other, like Angela Carter.
There are the two, my two favorite attempts to sort of retell and reimagine fairy tales are this great book of poems called Transformations by Anne Sexton and Angela Carter, an English writer who retold any number of fairy tales. And I paused over that because I thought, well, this has been done by two monumental writers. Is it done? Are we done with that? And then I thought, well, Angela Carter didn't stop Anne Sexton from doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of figured, you know, the fact that there's been a lot of love stories already written doesn't mean you don't get to write your own love story. Because the subject may stay the same, but everybody's book is going to be different. But yes, I love Transformations. It's one of my favorite Anne Sexton collections. Yeah.
I'll sort of follow up on that. Were there any books that you were writing against? Any authors that you're like, boy, I hate what, just sort of in general, what?
No. No, I don't really work that way. I mean, there are
cautionary
tales.
There are
certainly writers whose work I don't like. There is occasionally a writer whose work I think is overestimated. I would not name names.
Yeah.
Years ago, Esquire magazine asked a whole group of writers to ask who they thought were the most underrated and overrated writers around. Everybody's like, "I'm going to wait to tear into it," except Tennessee Williams, who named several writers he felt were deserving of more attention, and then said, "And I cannot imagine any writer being overrated."
That is lovely. That is lovely. You know, Esquire just published the 80 books that any man should read, and 79 were by men.
Surprise.
One by a woman, and it was Flannery O'Connor, who they probably thought was a man. any other questions? Yes, how about right there? Oh, good question. The question is whether delving into the structure of classic fairy tales made you think about your own, like in the novels.
Absolutely. I mean, one of the things you're doing as a novelist is you're spending your life learning how to write a novel by writing them, and you die, I think, still trying to learn how to write a novel. So I think, you know, I try to pick up what I can from everything I read, and certainly the kind of straightforward narrative structures of the fairy tales were a good reminder of the fact that you got to keep it going. You got to keep it going. These are six-year-olds. Mm-hmm. Don't underestimate them, but don't waste their time.
Also, the bluntness. They're just unafraid to make just, you know, moves without, like, okay, we're going to move over here. And, like, trust that the reader's going to go with you.
Yeah.
Wow. Impressive. Yes.
More comments than a question. You mentioned Disney versions as sanitized. Like, when I was a child, I see, like, a number of scary films, horror films. The one that scared me the most were actually Disney films.
Yeah. Disney. Yeah, question about scariness of Disney. Well, also the mother dies in like the first 5 minutes of most Disney films. And
they have to get the mother out of the way.
Yeah,
they do.
No, like Bambi terrified me.
Actually not a Disney movie with a mother in it.
Yeah.
I don't think because Disney was actually opposed to mothers, but you needed the protection of a mother needed to be removed for anything to happen to the protagonist. There, I lived for many years with a psychoanalyst, and there is actually a relatively high incidence of patients who have this isn't their only problem, but were so traumatized by Bambi, in particular.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Bambi, where the mother dies halfway through.
I was.
I mean, 45-year-olds are talking to their shrinks about that right now.
Yeah. Sign me up for that. Yes.
Thank you.
The characters are so moving. They're not in fairy tales originally, I don't think. But your characters are so moving. And the beauty of all of them.
So that was more just praise than a question about surprise and beauty.
No, thank you.
We'll take
thank
that.
You. That's lovely to hear.
Yeah.
That's great to hear. And I think it's important to sort of emphasize something that you said by implication, which is a novelist is just writing down what we all know already. Mm-hmm. That's how we recognize truth in the books we read. A novelist doesn't know anything that his or her readers don't know. The only difference is we're sitting in rooms writing it down.
Mm-hmm. But you honor our intelligence, and as what James Wood says, you are letting us co-create the world with you.
Yeah.
So, we're having all these aha moments. You're trusting our intelligence to you're not spoon feeding it to us.
No. I'm always writing for readers who are at least as smart as I am, and hopefully a little smarter. Yeah, you don't. You never condescend. You never.
Yeah. A couple more questions. How about right here? Yes.
And thank you for it, because it's a book that I've read umpteen times. I don't even know how many times. Sometimes I just pick it up where it falls and I'm reading it from there. And I'm fascinated by it. And I think my question is, did Mrs. Dalloway inform your need to tell Richard's story that way? Or was it Richard's story that somehow evoked Mrs. Dalloway?
Okay. The question is about the hours and the order of Mrs. Dalloway informing Richard, or Richard informing Dalloway?
Yeah. Very quickly, because not everyone has read it. There is a sort of contemporary version of Virginia Woolf's Miss Clarissa Dalloway, who lived in London in the 20s. Mine lives in New York today. And in the Wolf novel, there is a character named Septimus Warren Smith, who is a shell-shocked veteran of World War I. In Wolf's novel, Mrs. Dalloway and Septimus Smith never meet. In mine, they're close friends. I just wanted to make more obvious what Wolf, the greater writer, allowed to be subtle, because in the ultra-rational, prim, party-giving Clarissa Dalloway in Wolf's novel is sort of the ego to the deranged id of Septimus Warren Smith. And they live in separate spheres, but they are two parts of the same person. One is too rational, one is insufficiently rational. And I just put them together in the same room.
Yeah. Okay, how about back there? Yes.
What is the most difficult part of writing a book? Yeah. No, it's a good question. And honestly, the most difficult part of writing a book is not losing faith. It takes a really long time to write a book, and there are days when you feel like it's going pretty well, and there are days when you look at it and you think, "What was I thinking of? Why am I doing this?" Not to mention the fact that if a book takes 3 years, that's about what I seem to take for writing a novel. Toward the end of 3 years, you're not exactly the same person you were when you started. Things have happened in 3 years. So the book you find yourself bringing to a conclusion is not exactly the book you started out to write, because you're a slightly different person. And really, that's the big one, is just staying with it, just having faith in it, and getting through the periods when you think, I must be out of my mind. Why did I want to write this at all? And you strap yourself to the chair, and you do it anyway.
When you were first starting, Toni Morrison talks about giving herself permission and having figures that give you the permission to risk and to, you know, first try. Was there anybody or any person or any reading that sort of gave you permission or you felt like after, like, yes?
You know, it's good of Toni Morrison to bring that up, because I think she speaks for a lot of writers. There's this kind of notion of the writer as sort of brash and confident and Bunyan-esque and sort of striding into the editor's desk with the latest masterpiece. Mm-hmm. And actually, far more of us, I think, especially early on, but to some extent all of our lives, feel a little bit ashamed and a little bit like we don't really have the right to do this at all.
Right.
And if you can't overcome that to some degree, you can't write.
Right.
I think maybe the turning point for me, I'm going to have to keep this on the short side. I was much younger, in my 20s, just starting to write. Working in a bar in Laguna Beach, California, and there's also a terrible restaurant attached to the bar. It was called the Boom Boom Room, tropical motif. And there was a hostess in the awful restaurant who was in her 40s. She had four juvenile delinquent children. Her husband had left her like with a note saying, "Bye, honey. By the way, I don't think you know about those $50,000 in gambling debts." And so Helen, you know, worked worked in a bakery in the morning, typed manuscripts, that's how long ago it was, in the afternoon, was hostess in this awful restaurant at night, tried to keep her children out of jail, and she was an avid reader. And about, like every night she had about an hour to herself to read. And she was reading a mystery when I first met her, and I said, oh, you like mysteries. And okay, this is like the kind of pretentious that only a certain 23-year-old could be. I said, I bet you'd like Crime and Punishment. And she said, I'll give it a try. And she read it quickly. She's a fast reader, and she said, you know, that Dostoevsky was good. I said, yeah, he's good. He's, you know, he's really a lot better than Ken Follett. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But, you know, he's not as good as Scott Turow. And although I didn't agree with her, I loved it that she didn't have any sense of which of the books mm-hmm. she was supposed to like more. She reacted purely viscerally. And I'd been writing for a little while, you know, for Into the Ether, for History, for I don't know what, but I suddenly started thinking, what if I were to try to write something that would feel like something to Helen at the end of that impossibly difficult day? It wouldn't coddle, it wouldn't pander, but it would feel like enough. It would feel like enough life, enough depth, enough complexity, enough humor, and enough sorrow to be worth that precious hour she gave to it. Mm-hmm. And I think I don't know if that's quite the same as that feeling like you have permission, more like purpose. It gave mm-hmm. it a purpose. Yeah. And that kind of changed everything.
Wow. And do you still have her in mind?
I have her spirit in mind. She's no longer with us, but I have found, you know, when things, when I started publishing and stuff, I still write for about five people, mm-hmm. because I find that writing to the sky or just writing into the world is too abstract for me. Mm-hmm. So I write books for five or maybe six specific people, mm-hmm. and if other people want to read them too, that's great. But that's the only way I can work for me is, oh, you know, Kenny's going to really get this, mm-hmm. and Marie's going to love this ending.
Mm-hmm. That's it. Wonderful. Okay, how about one more question?
About Peter in By Nightfall. Mm-hmm. When you were writing about Peter, to which person you were writing to?
I'm sorry.
When you were writing Nightfall?
By Nightfall, yeah.
By Nightfall, which person were you writing to? Is that the...
About Peter.
Yeah.
About Peter.
Like, what reader was Peter sort of intended for, do you mean? Well, his name is Joe.
Okay.
And he's an art dealer. I wanted to write something specifically for Joe about certain questions we had about art.
Excellent. Well, if you have any more questions, please buy a book and ask him while you're signing.
You know, you can ask a question without buying a book.
Yeah. But thanks so much, Michael.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.